50 years ago today, humans set foot on the moon for the first time. To me, the Apollo 11 mission represents us coming together to reach our fullest potential as scientists and explorers. A vast amount of data was collected during the Apollo missions, including physical samples from the moon itself. And scientists are still studying these moon rocks to uncover secrets of our solar system. And guess what? We're gonna meet one of those scientists right now. Welcome back to Science in Real Life. I'm Molly, and this is our super special guest, Yaya Ku. She's a PhD student in the Jacobsen Lab in the Department of Earth and Planetary Sciences at Harvard University. And she's a moon scientist, which makes her the perfect guest for this episode celebrating the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11. So Yaya is working on a super important question, which is, how did the moon form? The one up there, not this one.
That's right. So we have generally good idea about how the moon was formed, but I'm adding more details to the story. So the leading hypothesis is called the giant impact. Around like 4.5 billion years ago, when our solar system just started to form, there's a Mars-sized planet collided into our Earth, and all of the debris just ejected and went around the Earth's orbit. And those debris eventually condensed to our moon.
Also, our beautiful, tranquil moon is the result of this cataclysmic event billions of years ago.
That's right. But we're still figuring out the details about the impact hypothesis. For example, it makes sense that the moon rock and then the Earth's rock share similar composition because after the impact, the Earth's debris and then the impact debris just got mixed up together. That's why we have observed a lot of chemical similarity between Earth and then the moon. However, we do observe some major differences between moon and Earth's rock, for example, potassium isotopes, that suggest after the impact, there might be more complicated process happen, which would provide more details about how the moon was formed.
Let's do a quick refresher on isotopes. The identity of an element like potassium or gold or oxygen is defined by the number of protons in an atom of that element. So all potassium atoms have 19 protons, and that's what makes potassium potassium. Gold has 79 protons, oxygen has 8. But the atoms of a given element can vary in the number of neutrons they have, and that's what an isotope is. So most potassium atoms have 20 neutrons, but there are potassium isotopes out there that have 21 or even 22. We call these isotopes heavy because they weigh a little bit more than the regular potassium atoms.
That's right. So different isotopes have different masses. Therefore, they behave differently under different conditions. By measuring their isotopic composition can tell us how a planet or moon was formed. So my job is to measure potassium isotope on the Earth's rock and then the moon rock to see what is the differences and then how those differences can tell us the origin story of our moon. So the first step is to get some moon rocks. Suits so that we don't contaminate our samples. So all the experiments that we did, we have to be under the very clean environment. And this is our clean room that we put our samples in, and we're gonna take a look at our moon rocks.
Oh my god, this is the best day of my life. Okay, there they are.
So those are the moon rocks, but they're not the rocks that you imagine. They're actually just a few milligram powders of debris that stored in the jar that NASA sent it to us. And one of the samples from the Apollo 17, which is the last manned mission that launched to the moon.
Oh my gosh, wow.
So first of all, we're gonna grind our moon rocks into a very fine powder. And then this is how we do it, just use the pestle and the mortar.
Oh my god, you're just grinding up the moon. Yeah, you're just grinds up the moon as part of your day. I will be honest with you though, For the purposes of demonstrating this experiment today, we are using Earth rocks because we don't want to waste the precious moon samples. Don't worry, I'm going to show you the real thing in a few minutes. But Yaya just casually grinds up the moon every day as part of her research.
Yeah. The next step is to use the strong acid to dissolve the powder. And this is the acid that we used, and they're so concentrated.
Oh yeah, that's the stuff that the bad guys use to dissolve bodies in crime shows.
So now we're gonna add acid to the powder.
Yeah, I'm gonna let you do that.
Okay. So this is how it looks like when the moon rock is dissolved in the acid.
Moon's dissolved in acid. Wow, what a day.
There are like a lot of chemical compounds in this solution, but I'm only interested in potassium. Then the next step is to separate potassium from all of other elements. Right. And what we use is the called column chemistry. Each one is a column, and then those orange stuff is the very special resin. So when you load your solutions into the column, different elements will come out at different speed. And we calibrate it so we know in which time and volume that potassium is coming out. So we just collect the potassium and then analyze that solution.
I had to do column chromatography for my organic chemistry lab final, and it would have been way cooler if we were separating moon rocks, Professor Rutledge.
So I'm gonna demonstrate how we do that.
Moon acid on a column. Okay, so that's all of your dissolved moon.
Yep.
And everything's gonna flow through the resin.
Exactly. So now sodium is coming, but I don't want it, so I'll just take it.
Bye, sodium.
Dump it. Next is magnesium, and we're not interested in that too.
We don't want that either.
Magnesium coming out. Uh-uh. Not interested.
Uh-uh.
Bye, magnesium.
Bye.
And this is time for potassium to come out. So we use a clean beaker, and then we collect potassium.
It's potassium time.
So now this beaker contains only potassium that is in the moon rocks. However, we're going to study the isotopic composition, and we need something to separate different isotopes. That's why we're using a very cool instrument called the mass spec to measure the potassium isotopes. This mass spec instrument is called multi-collector inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometer.
Dang. Okay, so it's going to tell us very precisely the ratio of the isotopes in our potassium.
Yeah, this is the control panel that we control everything here.
That's a lot of buttons.
Remember, we just collect the potassium isotope and then we put it there. And then we will hit the bottom so that the probe will go to the beaker, and then the solution will like travel through the instrument. So now all the potassium isotopes are traveling in this machine until it hits the magnet part. So the lighter isotope will be bended by the magnet more than the heavier one because they have the same charge, but then the lighter ones have larger charge mass ratio. So like imagine they come in the same angle, but they hit the magnet, and then the lighter one got bended more than the heavier ones. So it just travel, and then this is the lighter one, just like bended and collected here, while the heavier one is still going through straight. We're able to figure out the ratio and then the composition in the moon rocks.
Okay, so we've run our moon potassium samples on the ICPMS. What do they tell us about how the moon formed?
Okay, so this is still the work in process, but I will discuss some possible scenarios. So imagine forming the planets or the moon by cooking a pot of soup.
Love it. Planets being born equals soup.
Yeah, so very hot and swirling, bubbling everywhere. Mm-hmm. There are two scenarios that is most discussed right now. The first one is after the impact, the moon sort of separate from the Earth. Uh-huh. And then the moon soup got really hot, and then the light isotope just escaped into the outer space. So the moon itself is enriched in the heavier isotope than the Earth. And in this scenario, we would observe a really huge isotopic difference between those two planetary bodies.
So you got like a chunky minestrone, nice and heavy,
yeah,
and like a light broth.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. And then the second scenario is after the impact, the moon and Earth are in the huge clouds of vapor debris mixture. Mm-hmm. So you can consider it as a cooking pot with a lid on. So everything is just one single reservoir.
It's bubbling together. Yeah.
Yeah. So the potassium isotope composition in the moon rock and in the Earth rock will be pretty similar, just with very little differences.
It's like they're both chicken soup, but one has a little more noodles.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's perfect.
I can't wait to find out what you discover. All right, Yaya. We did promise everyone we'd show them some moon rocks. Let's go. There it is. There's the moon rock. Can you believe it? It's part of the Harvard Museum of Natural History's mm-hmm. special exhibit about the moon, so if you're in the Boston area, definitely come check it out. Yaya, it is so amazing to meet a moon scientist. Thank you so much for telling us all about your research. It's really out of this world. And don't forget to subscribe to Science in Real Life and check out those other videos in the Apollo Collab. Mm-hmm. We Create EDU is a community of educational YouTubers, and we've all gotten together to make videos to celebrate the Apollo anniversary. So check out those cool. if you want to see more. We'll see you next time.